For W3C, but I am not here in a W3C capacity. I am talking about a tool called Scour. It is a little bit W3C related. The primary author of Scour is Jeff Schiller, who is the chair of the SVG Interest Group. Anybody who's interested in SVG and interested in helping move the direction of SVG, change the direction of SVG, is welcome to join the SVG Interest Group. But today I will just be presenting about Scour. So, as a disclaimer, I love Inkscape, I really do, but this is tough love, so I have some problems with it. I made this image from a clip art that I found, all that had been authored by Inkscape, obviously. Okay, and I'm just going to show you some of the problems that I had with that. All right, so here's the eye. So that's the eye, and I will just open it with the text editor. That's just as good as the regular graphical view, right? You can see here all the cruft that Inkscape puts into a file. All the sodium-coding Inkscape namespaces. There's file-specific, or there's round-tripping metadata, and lots of other problems. They wouldn't be so much problems, except that we are... SVG is... One of the uses of SVG is as a web format. And the stuff that Inkscape and Illustrator put out is not really web-ready. It's too large, and it has a few other problems. So some of the problems... custom namespaces all over the place for both Inkscape and Illustrator. Round-tripping metadata, unused hidden content, sometimes quite large content. I'll show you an example in a moment. Duplicate gradient definitions, fixed dimension size. So fixed dimension size, it says this file is 400 pixels by 800 pixels, which is great for printing, terrible for the web. You want SVGs to be automatically scalable. When you embed an SVG, you want it to fit to the viewport that you're trying to fill. And many authors just don't know how to do that. It's very easy, but it uses CSS properties instead of attributes. And this causes file bloat. Another main problem with the use of CSS in Inkscape is that it really bloats the file size because it introduces properties that it doesn't need to, things that are defaults or things that don't have any effect. Like they'll have stroke none and then define all the different properties of the stroke. You don't need that. For web use, you often want to have an external raster. You want to have an internal raster image, a Base64 encoded raster image, because if you just upload an SVG file, you can't associate it with a particular raster image that might also be included in it. There's a lot of broken Wikimedia content because of this. So all of these things up here are things that are fixed by Scour. Some of the things that are upcoming, complicated transforms, which several nested transforms that are very difficult to work with when you are trying to when you're trying to combine different pieces of content or trying to use the content in a different way. All these nested transforms really confuse how you can do that. Floating point precision. Inkscape and Illustrator both go out to about 6 or 7 points precision when they really only need about 2. And when you're talking about large numbers of numbers, you're talking about significant file sizes. And then also it's eventually going to clean up some of the path definitions. So let me go back to show you a lovely... So I showed you an Inkscape file. I'm going to show you a lovely Illustrator file, if I can.
It's
up here. Okay. So this actually is a beautiful flower file, but it's not so beautiful when you open it in a text editor. First, Illustrator puts in all these entities up here, which need to be resolved. Many of these problems also are problems, especially at the namespace problems. These are problems for embedding SVG in text HTML. If you take an SVG file and you embed it directly in an HTML file, you want it to simply work, and these things will prevent it from working. This is another purpose for Scour. Here you have a switch. If any of you know anything about the switch, it says oh, if you're if you understand Illustrator, here, put in this PGF file. Otherwise, use this SVG file. The SVG file is about, it goes down to about here. And then the rest of this is PGF. Oh, here we are. This is all PGF stuff from Illustrator. This file is about, 20 times bigger than it needs to be. So for the web, that's just not acceptable. Okay, so the problem with Scour is that it's rather difficult to use at the moment. You have to install something called Python. I don't know what that is. So you might be able to figure it out. But then you type in this command, an input and output, and there are optional arguments. So it's very easy to use. You give it the file name, it cleans out the file for you. Some of the future work that we're going to be doing is we're going to be making a web interface at planetsvg.com. Planetsvg.com is a community site for SVG that we're working on. So people will simply be able to upload their files and convert them into a web-ready file. We're also working on an Inkscape plugin so that people will be able to do all these functions natively through Inkscape. And obviously, we're going to add more features. So, comments to Jeff Schiller, who is the primary author, go to CodeDread. That's his IRC nick, and there's where you can download Scour at codedread.com, Scour. And if you're interested in getting feedback on SVG and text HTML, I talked to some of you earlier, you had some reservations about some of the things that are being done. You can write to both of these lists, www.svg@w3.org and publichtml@w3.org. And that's it. Any questions? Okay, great. Thank you.